Our castaway this week is the composer Miklos Rozsa, probably principally known for the many film scores he wrote in the great days of Hollywood. Mr. Rozsa, we're dumping you unsympathetically on a desert island. Could you endure loneliness?
I can try.
Would 8 discs help?
I think so. 80 would be better.
Of course. What's the first one you've chosen?
The first I've chosen is a Chaconne by Bach.
Why?
Now, I started out as a violinist. I started to play the violin when I was 5. When I was 7, I played in public. And I grew up with a violin. Later, I wrote 2 violin concerti, 1 for Heifetz. And he definitely played better the violin than I did. But the Chaconne was one of the pieces that impressed me most. I think this is the greatest violin music. And I chose a recording by Adolf Busch, not only because he's a great violinist, but I heard him in Leipzig. I studied in Leipzig at the conservatory, you see. When I was 18, I was born in Budapest and then went to Leipzig. And I heard Busch playing it in the Gewandhaus in a solo evening. I was tremendously impressed.
Adolf Busch playing the Bach Chaconne, BWV 1004. Now, you began to play the violin when you were 5. Was there a lot of music in the house?
Yes, there was, because my mother was a pianist. She was a pupil of Professor Thomann, who was a pupil of Liszt. And so I heard a whole Liszt repertoire that she had to play. Not only the rhapsodies, naturally, but all the consolations and so on. And I grew up partly with that. And I had an uncle who was a violinist, the first violinist in the opera. Actually, he was a colleague of Antal Doráti's father. And I became a pupil of Antal Doráti's father and studied chamber music with him.
I'm told you took to music so well that you could read music before you
could
read
words.
Oh,
yes, I could read music with 5. And I went to school with 6. So by that time, I could read music, but couldn't read normal writing.
You told us you went to study in Leipzig. Why did you go to Germany?
Well, it's very difficult to say. My father had a very large estate in Upper Hungary. And his idea was that I will take that one day over, naturally, and I should become a chemist. And I did not want to become a chemist. However, the question was, if I stay in Budapest after finishing school, I would have to go out to the university and study chemistry, and no music. Because he explained to me, you can't make a living with composition, and how right he was. But if I go to Leipzig, because after all, the Leipzig Conservatory was very famous, then I am on my own. I can do whatever I want. However, I must say, I was honest. I went to Leipzig and immatriculated in chemistry and in musicology. That he allowed. That was, you know, a science that was perfectly all right, nothing to do with compositions. And I went in every morning, 8 o'clock, to the laboratory in a white gown, you know, and worked there. And I had to pass a great building, and on the building it says Breitkopf and Hertel. This was a very old publishing firm, probably the oldest in Germany. And I thought, Breitkopf and Hertel, maybe one day they will publish my music. But I had to go to chemistry, and I got analysis to make. And I came up to the 16th analysis, and that I couldn't solve. And there was an assistant, Dr. Meyer, and when I came towards him, he already shook his hand. He said, no, it's not right. I went back, and for that, nothing came out. So I said, enough.
Yes.
I never went back.
You gave up chemistry.
I gave up chemistry. I went to the conservatory. I was accepted. I came home. I told my father honestly. He wrote a letter to my professor, who was Hermann Grabner, a pupil and successor of Max Reger. And he wrote back a letter that if anybody has the right to study composition, it's your son. And that did it.
Splendid. Let's have your second record. What's that to be?
When I was in Leipzig, I wrote everything, of course, and I had to write a motet. It was a Benedictus. And I showed it to, or my professor showed it to, Karl Straube, who was the successor of Johann Sebastian Bach, of Church of St. Thomas. And I went to see him, and he said, it's very good music, but it's completely unsingable. And I said, well, what shall I do? He said, you come to my choir in a Gewandhaus. We meet every Thursday, and you'll sing. I said, but I have no voice. I said, who cares about your voice? But you will be sitting there. I did that for 3 years, and I learned a repertoire, and I wrote a lot of choral music. Some of them was even performed at the BBC 2 years ago, which is singable now. And I sang all the great concerts, but sang again in quotations. I just opened my mouth and followed the music. The Ninth Symphony by Beethoven twice with Furtwängler and once with Bruno Walter. And these were memories I shall never forget. Apart from everything, I think the Ninth Symphony is the greatest music ever composed, especially the first movement, but the last movement is just incredible. It's one of the greatest achievements of human mind. So I choose the last movement of the Ninth Symphony by Beethoven.
The last movement of the Beethoven Ninth Symphony, Furtwängler conducting the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra. Your first composition was published while you were still a student.
I was still a student, and my opus one is a string trio. And actually, in the first performance at the conservatory, of course, I played the viola.
Thank you. When you graduated, what did you do? Did you stay in Germany?
I stayed in Germany until 1931, when I went to Paris and gave a concert. And the concert was in the École Normale de Musique. Mm-hmm. And there were many people, like Arthur Honegger and many musicians. And it was a tremendous success because I got 3-4 columns in the papers the next day. C'est l'homme du jour. And I always said, c'est le plat du jour.
The man of the day or the dish of the day.
That's right. So I thought, this is it. I stayed in Paris.
Now, to earn a living, I believe for a time you wrote some pop songs to be played in cinema intervals.
Yes, under a pseudonym. I was terribly ashamed of that, but that's all I could do.
Of course.
I didn't want to put my own name on it, of course, because at that time Monteux was playing my music in Paris, and it would have been impossible that you go to a Monteux concert and you hear a music of mine, or to a chamber music concert, and there was a foxtrot written by Miklos Rozsa. So I chose a name, Nick Tomei.
Yes.
I don't know how I chose it, but it was idiotic enough not to resemble my own name.
Let's have your third record. What shall that be?
Well, I was very fond of the music of Brahms and quite agreed with Bülow, who said, when he had heard the first symphony by Brahms, that this is the 10th symphony by Beethoven. It is just as great. And Bruno Walter became a very close friend of mine. He played my music in Austria, in Holland, and finally in America, in New York. So this performance is by Bruno Walter, who I think was one of the great conductors of our times.
An excerpt from the fourth movement of the Brahms First Symphony in C minor, Bruno Walter conducting the New York Philharmonic Orchestra. Quite soon you came to London.
In 1935 I came to London. I was to write a ballet. There was a very good company, Markova and Dolin.
Very good.
Excellent company, excellent dancers. And there was a lady, Dera de Moroda, and she wanted to do a Hungarian ballet called Hungaria, and wanted a Hungarian composer. Now, this is, again, one of those things. I come to London, and suddenly somebody was a Hungarian composer. That doesn't happen though every day. So I wrote this ballet based mostly on folk music, which suited me greatly, and actually that led me to the cinema.
You'd got to know a clever young French director, Jacques Feder.
Yes. Jacques Feder I met in Paris, and his wife was Françoise Rosé, mm-hmm. a very fine actress, and I knew them very well, both And one day he invited to his house and I said, why don't you improvise something? I said, well, what? I said, anything you like. I said, why don't you give me a theme? So he gave me a theme, a dramatic theme. A city is in uproar. The people are running around and so on. So I sat down to the piano and played a city in uproar. And he said, fine, that's all I wanted to know. Nothing happened else. And then a year later, I read it in the papers that he is in London. He stayed at the splendid hotel on Green Park. It's not there anymore. And I called him, and he said, this is wonderful. Could you come right away to the hotel because I am in great trouble? So I ran over to the hotel in a taxi, and I said, what's the trouble? He said, these idiots don't understand my French, and my English is not good enough. I want to have my laundry by tomorrow morning. Could you explain this? Well, I did. So he said, now we go out for dinner. I said, I'm sorry, I can't go for dinner because I have to go to my ballet. Oh, you wrote a ballet, he said. He said, yes, it's just came back from Glasgow. It's playing at the Duke of York Theatre, and I have to go there to see in what shape it is. Can I go with you? I said, of course. So he came, and he was enchanted. He just loved it. He said, this is it. And now we go out to celebrate. I didn't do celebrate what, but we went to Qualino's. Mm-hmm. And he ordered champagne. I don't drink. He drank one bottle. He ordered the second bottle. And as every gulp went down, his evaluation of me as a composer went up. At the end, I was the greatest composer ever written any music. But I thought, that's fine. He'll forget it by tomorrow. I took him home to his hotel, and he said, tomorrow Françoise is coming, my wife, and you come to lunch. I call you at 10 o'clock. I was sure he'd forget it. He didn't. He called me at 10 o'clock, and he said, Françoise is here. We expect you at 1 o'clock. So I was in his hotel, 1 o'clock, and we waited, 1, 1.30, 2, 2.30, still no lunch. And I said, she's late, but she's coming. And she came, a lady I didn't know, very elegant with a tremendous hat, and a gentleman, her husband. And they were introduced as Mr. and Mrs. Sieber, S-I-E-B-E-R. So Mrs. Sieber sat on my right at the table and Jacques Feder on my left. Suddenly she turned to me and said, is my song ready? I said, what song? And he said, Monsieur Feder told me that you were going to write the music for our film. In the meantime, I felt that Feder is pushing my left side. I said, well, the song is not quite ready, but I'm working on it. And I turned to Feder in a sotto voce whisper. I said, who is she? And he whispered back, you idiot, Marlene Dietrich. No, she was.
And you were supposed to be doing a song for her that nobody had told you.
No.
And that was your first piece of film writing,
that's
that
right.
Song.
That was Night Without Armour with Night Robert Donald and Marlene Dietrich.
Thank you.
Well, there we are. We've reached the point of your first film composition. Let's have your fourth record.
I knew very little of Debussy before I went to Paris. But suddenly a new world opened up to me, which is French Impressionism. And I chose La Mer.
Excerpt from the dialogue between wind and sea from Debussy's La Mer, the Philadelphia Orchestra conducted by Toscanini. You wrote that song for Marlene Dietrich. You began to work quite a lot with the studio that made that film, the Korda studio, Alexander Korda.
Yes, I did about 10 in England and then 4 in America. Mm-hmm. The first one was Night Without Armor, which he liked. I didn't meet him until it was finished. And he came to me and said, I like your music, you're going to work for me.
What took you to Hollywood?
Alexander Korda. We started The Thief of Baghdad here in London, 1939, summer 39. And suddenly on September 3rd, something unpleasant happened. And there was no more money to follow with the film. We recorded as much music as we could. And Alex went to America. He was a member of the United Artists Corporation and came back and said, United Artists is putting up money in America to finish the film, and I have to take over the key man. You're one of them. And actually, I asked, how long will I go for? He said, 2-3 months. Now I am there since 44 years.
Amen.
Does the composer conduct the recording sessions?
Well, in England I did not, but I was studying conducting in England. I must say I was very grateful that I had this idea. I went to the Trinity College because in Leipzig I didn't study any conducting. I was composing. I was not interested. I said, there's somebody else can do that. However, here I thought this is about time that I studied. I went to Trinity College of Music at Mandeville Place, and I was a pupil of Kennedy Scott, who was a great choral director, for 1 year. And then, when that finished, I was a pupil of John Fry, who conducted the orchestra, and I had to conduct a school orchestra too, mostly my own compositions to start with, but then I conducted both Elgar symphonies, I conducted the Planets, and anything, you know, what was spectacular and you can learn from. From then on, I conducted every score of mine.
Record number 5.
I was in Paris when I first saw Daphnis and Chloe. I first heard the music, Monteux conducting, who gave the first performance as well, in 1912. And then I heard him many times. And it, of course, is a splendor of orchestration, of color and imagination. And I think it's a great, great work. Let's hear it.
Thank you.
closing passage of Ravel's Daphnis and Chloe, the London Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Monteur, and there's also the choir of the Royal Opera House, Covent Garden. Looking down the long list of about 120 movies, you seem to have had spells of being, as it were, typecast as a musician. You had a kind of oriental jungle phase to start with.
That was because I came with The Thief of Baghdad.
And The Thief of Baghdad
led to... And the Jungle Book and The Four Feathers before, all oriental subject matters.
And some first-rate psychological thrillers. You did quite a section of those.
Yes, the first one was Spellbound for Hitchcock. And after came The Lost Weekend. And
Double Indemnity, I remember.
Double Indemnity and so on, about 10.
You were a pioneer in the use of electronic music in thrillers.
Yes, as a matter of fact, I was the first one who used electronic music, which was the theremin.
Yes.
Which was hardly known at that time.
It was a French invention,
wasn't it? It was a Russian. Theremin was a Russian physicist.
Mm-hmm.
And he came to the West in 1922 and played his instrument everywhere, in England, in Paris, in America. And it was a fantastic instrument, quite out of this world sound. And finally, I came to Spellbound, where Mr. Hitchcock said, "I want a new sound." I said, "Theremin." And Mr. Selznick, who was a producer, said, "Is that an Italian dish?" But I have to explain.
Now, you say in the book that musically, the best score that you wrote in Hollywood was Spellbound, because Hitchcock wanted a big love theme for Gregory Peck and Ingrid Bergman.
Yes.
And in fact, you got an Oscar for it.
Yes,
But Hitchcock didn't actually like it.
No, he didn't get an Oscar. He couldn't...
get an Oscar and you did, and that's why he didn't like it.
Well, he said that... He didn't say it to me. Anyway, when I got an Oscar, I got a telegram from Mr. Selznick, who was the producer, not from Mr. Hitchcock, not a word.
Is that right?
I never talked to him ever since. And there were big sequences, silent sequences, where really the music took over. It had to take over.
Yes.
It was about amnesia, about paranoia, you know. It's only you can tell it with music, not with acting. He didn't like that.
You created, though, the musical standpoint of which marked itself on Hitchcock's films, the eerie effect, if you like, the creeping, tingling effect that's created by the right musical score at the right moment.
I think so. He didn't think so, I think. He thought I was taking away from his direction.
Thank you.
The next phase of your music, you became an authority on the music for historical epics. You did Ben Hur, for example, which must have been quite a task.
There was another episode in my life, and that was the gangster films, the film noir. Mm.
Kitty, what's up?
I'm taking my life in my hands coming to you like this, but I just couldn't stand by, not after what you did for me that time in Philly.
Forget that. Why are you here now?
Colfax thinks I'm on my way to New York. He's meeting me there tomorrow, but I just had to come to your suite and tell you.
Tell me what?
They're planning to double-cross you.
Who is?
Colfax and the others. They don't intend for you ever to get a smell of the money from tomorrow's job.
How do you know that?
Colfax sprang it tonight on Dum Dum and Blinky right after you left. First he called your names and said dirty things about you, and then he sprung it. What if they were not to go to the halfway house after the robbery? You'd go there. They'd be someplace else, and so would the money.
What did Blinky and Dum Dum say?
They fell right in with the idea.
Where are they going to meet?
At a farmhouse north of town on Polk Road, 11 miles out on the turnpike. Colfax hates you, sweet. So much so that Blinky and Dum Dum have caught it from him, and they hate you, too.
Thanks for putting me wise, kid.
What are you going to do? Sweet, what are you going to do?
I'm going to do them like they mean to do me.
Promise me one thing. You won't give me away. If Colfax ever found out what I did...
Don't you worry.
And then came finally, in 1950, the first historical, or shall we say, bibliohistorical film, Quo Vadis. Now, whether I succeeded or not is not for me to say, but I tried to recreate the music of the first century.
How many Oscars did you win?
Three.
Have you won?
Three.
For which films?
The first was for Spellbound. I must say, in brackets, that Mr. Hitchcock was nominated, but he did not get an award, so he didn't send me a telegram to congratulate me. The second was, which is indicative for my book, A Double Life, which was a very good film, a psychological film again, with Ronald Coleman. And the third one was Ben Hur.
Now, the nominees for the best music score of a dramatic or a comedy picture are Miklos Rozsa for Ben-Hur, Alfred Newman for The Diary of Anne Frank, Franz Waxman for The Nun Story, Ernest Gold for On the Beach, and Frank Duvall for Pillow Talk. And the winner is Ben-Hur, Miklos Rozsa. I would like to thank to all the musicians who played my music for Ben Hur, and most of them are here in this orchestra. Without their splendid cooperation, this award wouldn't have been possible.
of all the directors you worked for, Minnelli and...
Billy Wilder, William Wyler. Yeah.
Of all of them, whom did you respect the most?
Billy Wilder, in his earliest day, was the most wonderful man. Full of ideas, very artistic. We worked together on the piano. I played him everything, every sequence. He had something to say. And it was a great pleasure. It was also a pleasure to work with Minnelli.
The films that you wrote for and the scores that you wrote for all of them, of those, which was the film that you felt your music was just almost perfect for, complete perfection?
Well, I think that I am the proudest of Ben Hur.
Ben Hur, yeah. Why?
Because the whole subject matter was very close to my heart, and I had a great opportunity for drama, for recreation of the music of the early century, of everything. Vovadis was also a very important film from my point of view, but it was so badly dubbed that you could hardly hear the music, so I lost out.
Now, you took the title, The Double Life. You pinched the title of that Robert Hellman
film. I did pinch it, but I left the A out.
Because it is very applicable to your own professional career.
That's right.
Let's break off your sixth record.
I was in London and wrote the music for the VIPs, Elizabeth Taylor and Burton. And the director was Anthony Asquith, a very fine gentleman. And one day he said, I'm going to bring you tomorrow something. And he brought me the score, not the record, the score of Britain's War Requiem. Well, I didn't sleep all night. I was reading that score, and they said, when is it going to be recorded? And he said, very soon. Apparently, he was a friend of Britain. And finally, I got the record, too, and I was enchanted.
Part of the Dies Irae from Benjamin Britten's War Requiem, a recording conducted by the composer. Of your many, shall I use the word serious, but of your many compositions written entirely for yourself, which are your favourites? Which ones do you like to
Well, they all belong to a certain period. My biggest success was Theme Variations and Finale. The first performance was given by Charles Münch, then Bruno Walter gave it all over the world, and actually Leonard Bernstein made his debut with this work.
Mm-hmm.
And it was played everywhere. There were 150 performances.
Yeah. Mr. Bernstein will next conduct a Theme, Variations, and Finale by the 36-year-old Hungarian musician Miklos Rozsa. The theme of the composition was conceived, according to the composer, in the manner of a Hungarian folk song, although it is not of folk origin itself. It is then treated in eight variations of contrasting feeling and summarized in a new form in a wild and swift finale. Miklos Rozsa was born in Budapest, and before completing his studies at Leipzig, was offered a long-term publishing contract for his compositions. Hungary soon recognized his work by awarding him its highest music honor, the Francis Joseph Prize. Rozsa lived in Paris and London before coming to the United States in 1940 to write music for the motion picture The Thief of Baghdad. He has had a successful career in Hollywood since then, composing the scores for The Jungle Book, That Hamilton Woman, Five Graves to Cairo, and a number of other pictures. Leonard Bernstein now conducts the theme, variations, and finale by Miklos Rozsa.
But then I wrote five concerti, one for Heifetz, one for Piatigoski and Heifetz, one for an American pianist Leonard Penario, then for Janos Starko, cello concerto, and I just had the first performance of my viola concerto in Pittsburgh, which I wrote for Pinker Zuckerman. It was conducted by Andre Previn.
We've got to your seventh record. What shall that be?
Record number 7 is Stravinsky's Sacre du Printemps, The Rite of Spring. I heard this the first time in Paris, conducted by Montu. But I have to tell you a story that I was in London in 1963, May 29th, which was the 50th anniversary of the date when Montu conducted the same work in Paris, in the Théâtre des Champs-Élysées, where there was a tremendous scandal.
A riot, almost.
A riot. And Stravinsky jumped out of the window to save his neck. And now 50 years have gone, and in Albert Hall, Montu was about 85 or 86 conducting this work. Stravinsky was sitting in a box with his wife, and this old gentleman, Montu, came out, and I was afraid what is going to happen, because he didn't look that he's going to live through the performance. But it was a fantastic performance. The whole audience jumped up. There was a standing ovation. The orchestra jumped up and everybody started Stravinsky, Stravinsky. And there in a box, this old gentleman bowed. They wanted him on the podium, but he couldn't walk anymore. And everybody was standing, everybody was shouting. Stravinsky took bows, but no Montu. Monto disappeared. Suddenly, about 10 minutes later, he came into the box. You know how large Albert Hall is. Mm-hmm. He walked around to came into the box of Stravinsky. The two old men embraced each other, and everybody cried. I cried, too. It was the most touching experience of my life. Let's hear the end, the Danse Sacrale from The Rite of Spring.
Closing passage of Stravinsky's Rite of Spring, the Columbia Symphony Orchestra conducted by the composer himself. We've put you on this island. We'd give you a certain amount of help to make a hut and so forth, but could you look after yourself? Can you cook? Ever done any fishing?
No, I'm completely impractical.
If there
the
was
only a thing I can do is write music, nothing else.
I don't know what you're going to write music on or with, except we are going to give you a luxury. Would that be the most important thing? Would you like some manuscript paper?
Yes, I would say so.
And plenty of pens and ink?
Yes, please.
All right. But I'm a little bit worried about how you're going to manage.
Fish, probably, you can catch with your hands.
Thank you.
The last record is the Concerto for Orchestra by Béla Bartók. Bartók is very close to me, not only because he's a Hungarian, but because he's a great composer and because of this very tragic life. He lived his last 5 years of his life in America.
Who's conducting this recording?
This is a friend of mine, a very close friend of mine who has done much of my music, and I admire him enormously, Sir George Shorty.
An excerpt from Bartók's Concerto for Orchestra, Sir George Shorty conducting the Chicago Symphony Orchestra. If you could take just one disc you've played us, Mr. Rozsa, which would it be?
Well, I think the Beethoven, because the Ninth Symphony for me is the beginning and the end of music.
You told us your one luxury. You're allowed one book. You already have the Bible and the complete works of Shakespeare.
Yes.
One book.
Well, there I have to ask your forgiveness, because I'm going to ask for a Hungarian book.
That's all right, that's fine. What is the title in Hungarian and also in English?
Well, I would like to have the collected poems of a great Hungarian poet, probably the greatest of this century, but unfortunately poetry cannot be translated. His name is Adi, A-D-Y, Endre Adi. And he influenced me very much in my youth. I wrote a lot of songs on his poems, and I still would like to write more.
Right. The Hungarian poems of Adi. And thank you, Miklos Rozsa, for letting us hear your Desert Island discs.
Thank you so much to ask me here.
Goodbye, everyone.